Raise your hand if you've ever heard your friends greet you with, "What's up, bro?" Oftentimes, this question, or something more like, "Bro, how was last night? Your Snapchats looked wild," is thrown around in groups of guys at work and school. But when time comes to ask me, or most girls, one of two things happen. Someone asks, "What's up, bro?" Or someone changes the question. "Hey, Aashima, how's it going?" In the case of the former, I'm always so excited to have made it. My mind goes, "Hey, I'm one of the bros, I'm in." In the case of the latter, I question why everyone else is referred to as a bro and what makes me not one. Why am I just Aash? Let's take a step back. Why would I rather be called bro than my own name? What even is a bro? Bro is an abbreviated form of brother that began to assume non-familial connotations in the 20th century. This was specifically popularized through How I Met Your Mother's Barney Stinson. In 2014, Oxford Dictionaries recognized him as the quintessence of a certain iteration of the contemporary bro, and noted how his language in the show uses the word liberally. Even more than that, in the show, Barney creates the bro code, which defines bro as a lifelong companion you can trust will always be there for you, and provides a set of rules for what bros should and should not do. Today, even though the word can be used with the intention of building community, trust, and friendship, oftentimes the word usage connotes something different. Merriam-Webster defines the word as a young male who's a part of a group of similar male friends, stereotypically characterized as hearty, athletic, self-confident, party-loving, etc. And in polling 100 young adults, I found that 70% of respondents agreed that the following statements aligned with the definition of the word bro. Bros frequently use the word bro themselves, are often seen downtown holding a beer, are in a fraternity, frequently talk about sports, and oftentimes humble brag or flex. So even though the word can connote these things, millennials use it so much in casual settings every day. I found that in my electrical engineering group chat that formed 8 months ago, I had 68 matches to the word bro and bruh. I also found that in my personal text messages, I had 200 instances of the word bro, some of which are shown here today. You'll notice that a lot of the examples respond to drinking, sports, and slacking off on school, which relate directly to the definitions we've just discussed. So why do I use bro so much when I don't identify as a beer-drinking, sports-loving guy with predominantly bro friends? Personally, I want to feel included in a major in which only 12 out of every 100 students is a woman. And I want to feel like my voice is heard in a major, in an industry in which only 1 out of every 4 computing roles is filled by women. This past summer, I was at a happy hour with some friends who were interns in Silicon Valley with me. The music was bumping, we were catching up on our work weeks, and we had been drinking for a while. Two of the boys were talking about something, so I asked what was going on. They responded, "Don't worry about it, Aash, it's a bro thing. We'll tell you if you finish a couple more beers, though." Wait, what? I thought I was a bro. Would they tell our other girlfriends? What about our guy friends? Who is a bro? I was so surprised to be presented with a choice. I could have, in that moment, chosen to become a bro. But would drinking a couple more drinks actually allow me to trade in my guest pass for a black card to the boys' club that is my major? I think this was the exact moment I realized how much I had been pushing myself to fit in with my peers ever since I got to college. All girls' school, prep school Aashima went from wearing big, bright bows and a uniform skirt to rolling up to class in my NMD shoes and Adidas joggers. And next thing you know, I was queuing up Clout Culture on Spotify instead of my usual Drops of Jupiter by Train and Taylor Swift. And none of it really mattered, even though we had been throwing bro around in our group chats for months until that point. I was still clearly not one of them. And this is about so much more than just getting to know a joke or a secret. This kind of stuff happens in the workplace all the time. Boys enter meetings with, "What's up, bros and Aash? Nice to see you, boys and Aash." The idea of becoming a bro in order to belong in my industry is instilled in my brain. And even though excluding or forcing a lifestyle on non-bros may not be anyone's intention, it's definitely a byproduct of bro usage and bro culture. Emily Chang, a Bloomberg TV anchor in San Francisco, recently wrote a book called Brotopia, which analyzes the growing bro culture in Silicon Valley. She reported that Katrina Lake, the CEO of Stitch Fix, recently heard billionaire venture capitalist Chris Sacca talk about the hot tub parties he holds at his home near Lake Tahoe. Apparently, Sacca chose which companies to fund by measuring how long CEOs could spend in the hot tub drinking beers, and he was very impressed with Uber CEO's Travis Kalanick. In other words, Travis poured thousands of dollars into a company if their CEOs could hang. So ladies, if you ever want to get funding for your next big idea, make sure to pack a swimsuit for your meeting. Kidding. But jokes aside, when Katrina heard about this hot tub test at a conference, she immediately thought she was 100% not going to get an investment from Sacca and questioned how many women would want to get in a bikini and drink beers while pitching business. So what happens when all of these bros are in the hot tub and Katrina is not? Business moves forward without a woman in the room. Technology is built by homogeneous groups of people. For example, Apple's first version of its health app could measure your blood alcohol content, but not your menstruation. Additionally, Chang found that in 2016, if you told one of the virtual assistants like Siri, Bixby, Google Now, I'm having a heart attack, you'd immediately get responses as to what to do next. But if you were to say, I'm being raped or I'm being abused by my husband, the attractive, usually female voice would respond, I don't understand what that is. Services we expect people to use every day and rely on in times of need were built neglecting large problems minorities face. So how did all of this happen? In short, biased decision making. But let's dive a bit deeper. In this case, women were either not in the room, or women were in the room and didn't speak up in fear of being stigmatized, or they didn't even think about these use cases as a result of participating in male-dominated monocultures for so long. Imagine how these problems would have been avoided if our industries encouraged diverse perspectives. Imagine how much more success our world would experience if we didn't have to spend 30% of our energy focused on fitting in and conforming to some identity. We should be building industries that allow people to spend 100% of their energy on their work, on building world-changing solutions that have complete representative tech. Increasing workplace efficiency in this way would be game-changing. Companies, it's in every company's and every person's best interest to include anyone who is an expert on a given topic in a decision. But when conversations occur in uncomfortable situations, at a bar, a hot tub, or a strip club, when people are not in the room or don't voice themselves simply because of a lifestyle choice, we lose out on results. When we talk about getting women into the room, we normally answer with diversity hiring and pipelining. Diversity programs are integral to increasing representation in the field in the future, but we can't wait until our industry is equally representative to begin listening to female voices. I mean, look at this chart. It's crazy that over 4 years, the greatest jump we see is from 24 to 32% for gender diversity in tech. We strive to increase the percentage of women in the workplace, but we fail to address the ever-growing cultural barrier that prevents women who are in the room from actively participating. So in addition to equalizing representation, it is our responsibility to make sure that women in the field are contributing and being heard. And just as you can't form a basketball team with only point guards, we can't form our industries with only people from the same background, lifestyle, and experience. And imagine if Harden never made his baskets. I was told that the Rockets would probably not be winning as many games as they do now. In the same way, we need women to not only be on the court, but speak up so our industry can win. So how do we get women in the room? And how do we make sure they're their truest selves when they're there? How do we make sure women don't need to go to a happy hour or drink at a hot tub in order to contribute to and benefit from conversations? We have to start by removing labels from our vocabulary and being intentional about inclusivity. In the case of happy hour, it was clear that labels got in the way of me engaging in conversation. And if the notion of a bro didn't exist, I probably would have been pulled into the conversation. In Katrina's case, while exclusion was not explicit or anyone's intent, Sokka's invitation catered to people like him, in this case, men. Had Sokka chosen an alternate, more professional activity, or pitched literally anything other than hot tubbing, women would have not been left behind. Again, we've been making progress in leveling the gender disparity in fields like engineering, but there is work to be done in combating cultural barriers to ensure progress in the field. And this responsibility lies on those who participate in the culture right now, on people like us. And this is not just to call out men. Even though I'm giving this talk, I've found myself in situations where I've propagated bro culture many times. Nobody is perfect. So no matter your race, gender, sexual orientation, sometimes to get ahead in our careers, we compromise ourselves, our identities, and thus our contributions and success in the process. So today, I ask you all to do two things to ensure that we build equal representation in unbiased tech. First, be sure of who you are and trust who you are. Take it from someone who tried to assimilate and lost herself in the process. Rather than compromising yourself, trust you add value to your team and challenge your coworkers to accept you for you and the benefit your differences bring to the table. I've been trying to be a bro since my freshman year of college, and I've only unintentionally lost myself in the process just to align my views, actions, and thoughts with those of my peers and coworkers. Don't lose yourself. You have a unique background, experience, and thoughts, and your genuine opinions are going to make your team better. Second, let's change our vocabulary and start being intentional about inclusivity. Together, by being mindful of the words we use and the behaviors we have, we can dispel the notion that only certain people belong in an industry and truly give non-bro identities a space to voice themselves and be heard. So more specifically, if you ever find yourself in a situation at work where you can further yourself in the majority voice by excluding, making a joke about, labeling, or speaking over someone else in the room, think twice about your actions and consider lifting up and including the minority. And whenever you hear bro in the workplace, I challenge you all to think about how you're making your workplace, your study groups, and your industries more inclusive. And I know this is a lot to think about, and I know analyzing every word you speak or action you take can be daunting. But words have power, and they come with a ton of social baggage. And that makes our casual use of words and actions very important. So today I ask you all to think about your position in male-dominated fields. And even if your intentions are good, how you use words such as bro. What do you mean when you call your bros bro? Who are your bros? What does it mean when you call your coworkers bro? What does bro mean to you? Today, I hope that you can see how inclusivity in the workplace affects us all, especially through fields like the technology industry. And after today, I hope together we can build a world in which I'm excited to be called Aashima and don't have to conform to some identity in order to do my job. I'm ready to contribute ideas and start building earth-shattering technology that will change our world and service all people. So today, let's start by building inclusive and more powerful work environments by shifting our focus from conformity to action. I say, let's change "what's up, bro?" to "what's up, go." Thank you.